Hello, Keith Rucker here at VintageMachinery.org. Guys, today we're back working on the Jimmy Diresta Bandsaw project. Previously, in the last episode that we did in this series, we had put a motor starter on this to start the motor, and I discovered that we had an issue where the motor was basically spinning up too fast. It was wanting the belt to kind of throw off, and it was really causing a lot of slippage and stuff in the belts because there's just a lot of inertia in this big wheel over here, and going from zero to 1725 RPMs like that was putting a lot of stress on things. So what I decided to do was, instead of using just a regular motor starter, to put a variable frequency drive on this machine for motor control purposes. Now, this will replace the motor starter. This has the motor starter capabilities built into it. But the main thing that I wanted out of this was basically what they call in the electronic world or motor starter world, a soft start. And what a soft start is that instead of when you hit the power to that motor and it just all going wide open right from the beginning and really being under a lot of stress, that motor starts up kind of slowly and builds up speed. It does that by varying the frequency of the electricity. Normal electricity here in the US is on 60 hertz, so 60 cycles per second in the alternating current. And basically what this variable frequency drive will do is it will start it off at a lower frequency, which will make that motor turn slower, and then it will ramp it up fairly quickly to where it's running at full speed. I'm hoping that solves the problem. It should solve the problem of my belt slippage and the belts wanting to come off the machine and just kind of getting it into going. But some of the other things that we can do with this variable frequency drive from a motor control standpoint is that when we hit the off button, we can actually have a motor brake in there so it'll spin down faster. You know, one thing, again, there's a lot of inertia in this machine. So when you click it off, those wheels and that blade may turn for, you know, a minute or two before it actually slows down. With the VFD, it has a motor brake built into it, so, you know, it will slow that motor down very fast so that you're not sitting there. From a safety standpoint, you won't be just sitting there with that blade running for a long time after you shut off the machine. We also can put a potentiometer in here. A potentiometer is just one of those little dials that you turn and get speed control. And again, I think that's going to be very helpful. According to the catalog, this thing's supposed to run at about 450 RPMs, which is a pretty fast surface speed, particularly on that 4-foot diameter wheel. I'd have to do the math to figure it up, but it's running really, really fast. With that potentiometer in there, that speed control dial in there, we can actually speed it up or slow it down to get it where it's cutting just like you want to and where the operator feels safe and comfortable running it. It's not just one speed for everything. So it's going to give us a lot of options and a lot of things that a regular motor starter by itself could not do. We will still have start-stop button built into it, and like I said, we'll have the speed control. I've got all those parts coming. I don't have those yet, but the actual variable frequency drive did show up yesterday, and I've been in the process. We're going to go ahead and start getting this thing installed, and through the course of this video, hopefully get everything hooked up to it. I won't finish the video up until everything comes in and we get everything hooked up and going. Now, this particular VFD that I've got on here, I source from Automation Direct, which is a company that sells these kinds of things. There's lots of places out there that sell VFDs. You can buy, you know, ones off of Amazon and places like that, fairly inexpensive, and they generally work. Now, I've dealt with quite a few VFDs over the years, but if I'm sourcing a VFD, and if you're sourcing a VFD, the first thing I will suggest you do is go online and look at the manual on this, because there is some programming that has to be done to get these things properly programmed to run with your specific motor that you're going to be running on it, and to be able to do all the functions you need to do. Go download the manual and make sure that you can read and understand that manual. One of the problems that I have seen with a lot of the El Cheapo VFDs is they're made in China, and their manuals are minimal at best, not very clear, that doesn't even make sense in a lot of cases. So find one that has a good manual. That's the most important thing you can do, because it's not, particularly when you start getting into the motor control aspects of using a VFD, it's not just as simple as just plugging some wires in there and walking away from it and let it go. You've got to be able to do some programming, and you got to be able to understand that. I sourced this particular one because I like the manual. It's good. And also the reason I sourced this particular one, which is an Iron Horse, is the brand, the trade name on it. Again, it came from Automation Direct, probably available from other sources as well. I'm not sure. But this is the same VFD that I put on my metal planer, and I really liked it when I did it. It's the best VFD I've ever worked with. I like the fact that this VFD has an enclosure. It comes built in with an enclosure around it. Most VFDs are just El Cheapo plastic again, and when you start putting wires and stuff on there, there's not really anything to hold all that wiring in place, and it can get kind of shaky unless you put that VFD inside an enclosure of some kind, which adds more expense to the whole project. This VFD comes in an enclosure that you can already has holes in there to be able to bring the cords in and out of with regular electrical fittings, etc. Has a huge heat sink on the back of this thing. These things do generate a lot of heat. So, you know, you got this big extruded aluminum heat sink on the back. So that's another big plus for it. I just felt like it was a very good unit. It is a little bit more expensive than the cheap VFDs, but I think you get your money out of this this particular one. I like it. It's made in Korea. It's not made in China. Still Asian, I guess you could say, but I have more confidence personally in stuff coming out of Korea, Taiwan, Japan than I do China. That's my personal opinion. You can agree or disagree with that if you like. But that's what I have found through my experience. The better stuff comes out of some of these other Asian countries over there. So there you go. This is what we got. We're going to get in here. We're going to get this thing installed and hopefully get it up and running. Let's bring you guys along for the ride. So to mount this on, I've come in and I've just put some metal brackets again off of this casting that we have on here. Same as we had done with the motor start that we had on here previously, although I did have to make some longer brackets to hold these and different spacing. Those were the holes where the starter was at before. I had to drill some new holes down here, again, make some new pieces. We got some mounting holes in here, and these are just held in place with some quarter inch bolts. I'm gonna go ahead and get these put in and attached. All right, I'm gonna get all these bolts tightened up and we'll get the front off of this and see if we can start doing some wiring. Now, whatever you do when you're getting a VFD, variable frequency drive for a machine, make sure you get one that's sized properly for your particular situation. And there's a lot of confusion out there because a lot of people, when they think of a variable frequency drive, they're thinking of using it as a way to generate three-phase power from single-phase power. And while they are used for that, and they can be very effective for that, what they're really designed for is motor control in a three-phase environment. So if you're going to use a single-phase input, you have to size it properly. So if you're using single-phase input, you need a bigger VFD than you do if you're using three-phase input. Now, in my situation, I have a rotary phase converter. I'm powering everything on three phase. So this particular phase converter or VFD that I have here is sized for a 7.5 horsepower motor, which is what I'm running at three phase. If I was doing single phase input, it would only be rated for a 3 horsepower motor. So that's one of the things that you run into with the VFD. If you are using single phase input, you got to size it up to a larger one to make it work properly. I will just tell you this particular VFD right here, it was about $650. Okay, fairly expensive. Yes, there are cheaper ones out there, but again, I feel like this is a better investment. But I can only run a 3 horsepower motor with this. So the VFDs, as your motor horsepower gets bigger and bigger, they quickly start becoming more and more expensive. And at some point, particularly if you're running larger motors, in a shop that doesn't have three-phase power, you quickly get to a point, even if you're running multiple machines in your shop, you quickly get to a point where even if you need the VFDs, it's cheaper to have a phase converter and feed these things three-phase power, be able to get smaller ones and run smaller wiring and everything else than to try to use a 220-volt single-phase input. You know, I'd still have to feed this thing with, I don't know how many amps I would have to have for a 3 horsepower motor, probably 30 amps. to feed a 3-horsepower motor, whereas the 30 amps I'm feeding it here can do a 7.5-horsepower motor. So even wire size and stuff starts becoming an issue when you get into the larger motors. All right, we're gonna go ahead. Well, I need to pull one more screw out here. Pull this cover off and get in here and take a look at this. All right, so in here, this is where all the electrical connections are made, and there's several things going on, but the main thing you got is the power that's coming into the machine. In this case, 3-phase power is gonna come up. There's 3 terminals right here. This is where L1, L2, L3 all connect in right here. And then the 3 terminals over on the right, this is what will output to the motor. So this will be basically T1, T2, T3. They have it marked U, V, and W in there. That will go to your 3-phase motor. Now, if you're doing single phase input, you got to put a jumper in here between 2 of these. It's all in the instructions. I'm not going to go into all that. I think there may be a dip switch that you might have to flip in here as well to tell that you're feeding it single phase input. I'm not sure. Again, it's in the instructions. I don't remember all that. But down here on the bottom, that's pretty much all we've got. Now up here, we've also got a bunch of connections. This is for your inputs for your motor controls. And again, everything is spelled out here in the manual. They came with a little quick start guide here that has some real nice schematics and stuff that will help you get this figured out. And we'll be tying into some of this stuff for our start-stop circuit with the stop-start button, as well as our potentiometer to do the speed control. And I think that basically there's 3 terminals up here that will plug into the potentiometer, and we got a couple down here that we plug into for the speed control. And there are lots of other things that you can control with this, depending on your situation. As far as the soft start and all that, you program it in up here. Again, the instructions tell you exactly how to do it. Right now, I've already got this program. I think we've got an 8-second ramp up time, and I think it's a 4-second brake time. So whenever we hit it, it'll slow the motor down in 4 seconds. It'll take 8 seconds to speed it up. All that's programmed in the soft start. We've also gone in here and programmed in here the specifics on the motor. We've told it what size motor we got, how many poles the motor has. We've told it, the RPM range, how many amps the motor is rated for, all that, which will help the VFD to make sure that it's sending the right signal out. Again, you can program all that in, all that information's in the manual. So we're gonna get some power plugged into this, get our motor coming out of the bottom. That's pretty much all I can do today because I don't have my motor control stuff yet, but we'll get all that coming in here a little bit later on. So I'm gonna get some of this stuff hooked up and we'll bring you back and let you see what we got. All right, quick update of where we are. So I got my power coming in, this flexible line coming in the bottom. I do have a strain relief on here so that will kind of help keep the where it doesn't pull out up there very easily and kind of keep a nice bend in this no matter how it goes. Power goes in, again, 3 phases. We got black, blue, and red, which is our colors for our 3-phase power, 220 volts. That goes into these 3 terminals here. And then coming out, going to my motor, I've got, again, black, blue, red. Coming out, it goes through this piece of flexible conduit up to the top. And I just got it wrapped around this motor. We'll move back and forth, so we got enough of a loop in there where we can do that with no problem at all. I will mention too that a lot of guys have made comments about the fact that this peckerhead or where the electrical connections are on this motor, where it's on the back side, and it'd be a lot more convenient if it was on this side, and that was an easy fix. All I had to do was take the end housings off this motor, flip the rotor around, turn the motor around, and boom. I've flipped them around, it's on the other side. And you can do that with a 3-phase motor. It's very easy to do. And most 3-phase motors, that's exactly right, you can do that one. I actually took this one apart, and there is a fan that's on the inside of this end of the motor. And the way that the coils and everything is in here, there has to be room for that fan. And there's only room for that fan on this side. So you really can't flip it around. There's really not a way to take the fan off the housing. Even if you did take the fan off and try to put it on the other side, it still wouldn't fit. So it just really wasn't an option. So, we just kind of had to leave it like it is And it's fine, we got plenty of adjustment in there. We would pick up another couple of extra inches of adjustment in this if we could do that, but we've got plenty of adjustment in here, so it's not an issue whatsoever. But I did try. And like I said, with all the comments that came in on that, I want to let you know that yes, normally you can do that, but in this particular motor, just not possible. All right, up next, we need to get our motor controls in here, and I need to wait to get some stuff in. So there's going to be a pause right now for me, for you guys. We'll pick up when those parts come in and get the rest of this thing wired up. In full disclosure here, I'm going to tell you guys, I know that these videos are put together where everything's just kind of all seamless together, but it's actually been about 2 weeks since I've worked on this machine because I've been on the road, I've been out of town, and when I have been in town, I've just been tied up with my real job work and so forth like that and haven't had time to get out here and work in the shop. So I'm kind of picking back up on this. I don't remember exactly where we left off, but I do know what the next thing that needs to be done is, and that's what we're about to jump on here. So the motor is on here. We've got the VFD pretty much hooked up and it's operating, but we've still got some alignment issues going on here between the motor and the machine. And two things that I want to accomplish. Number one is we've got adjustment in this motor going in and out to tighten and loosen the belt. But what we don't have is adjustment in and out in this direction to really align the pulley, this pulley with the pulley down below. You know, I kind of eyeballed it, but honestly, we didn't get it exactly where it needs to be. What I want to do is I'm going to actually pull the motor up. We're going to pull this plate off, and where I have the four holes, the mounting holes that are in here, we're going to take this over to the milling machine, and we're going to cut some slots in there where I have some adjustment to move this motor in and out, where I can really get it lined up exactly how it needs to be. Should have done that from the beginning, to be honest with you, but at the time, I just didn't think about it, but that's gonna make life a lot easier here. So that's what we're gonna do. I think what I'm gonna do is just pull the gantry over. We're just gonna kind of pick this motor straight up because it is wired up. I don't wanna disconnect it all. That will enable me to unbolt this plate, and we'll go to the milling machine and do that. So let's knock that out. Got my plate set up over here on the mill machine. Basically got the back of this just running parallel to the table, so it should be all lined up and square. Again, we're just making some slots, so I got an end mill in here. We'll go ahead and turn our mill on. I've already got it lined up. We're just gonna drop it right down in that hole. I'm gonna zero out my digital readout. I'm gonna make these slots about an inch long, and we're just gonna mill that out. So I'll do each one of them individually, and we should be good to go, so. All right, that's an inch. Just gonna mill back just to make sure everything's nice and smooth. That looks good. All right, we'll come to the other hole and knock it out. I'm gonna have to actually move my plate, I think, to get these on this side, just because it won't quite all fit in here like it is, but we'll make it, we'll get it where we get them all done. So I got my slots cut. We're going to go ahead and reinstall the motor over here where it belongs and get everything lined up properly, I hope, and go from there. Let me get a chance to get this bolted down where it needs to be. And we'll bring you guys back here in just a bit. All right, I got my bolts in, and as you can see, I've got about an inch of travel in here now to kind of fine tune the position of this, which is gonna be a big help. So I'm gonna go ahead and do some fine tuning here and figure out where this thing needs to go, and we'll bring you guys back. We'll give an update of where we are over here on the Jimmy Diresta bandsaw. It's been a little while since I've worked on this. I've been on the road a bunch and had some things going on, so I'm kind of catching back up, but I have taken care of a few little issues that we had with this thing, and I think I can say that it is now ready to go. So let's talk about the couple of changes that we made since we kind of last revisiting on this. First off, even after doing the slowing down, the soft start and whatever, I was still having some issue at startup where this belt is wanting to kind of run over. And it wasn't coming off the pulley, but it was dangerously close. So my solution to that is I put a little belt guard on here. All this is a piece of steel that kind of comes up. I got a bracket, and when this thing starts up, this belt will actually bump over on this, and it will keep it from coming off the pulley. And it's working really good, because basically whenever it comes over and touches that, it almost just bounces right back onto the pulley almost immediately. The other nice thing about this little belt guard that I put on here, and I'm just going to go ahead and say, I am not planning on building a guard to go on this belt system, but I think that it's probably a good idea. I'm going to leave that for Jimmy if he wants to do that. But assuming he does, this will actually give a mounting bracket that we can put a guard up on this belt system just for safety reasons. Kind of dual purposes, and I've actually got a plan to put a similar thing up on the front pulley, although it's not wanting, the belt's not wanting to run off, but have something up there that will make sure it stays on and also give us a mounting point again for a belt guard up there. So that's the first thing we did. The second kind of issue that I had was, I mentioned, I think early on with this VFD, one of the things I wanted to be able to do was to use the braking mechanism in it. So with a VFD, you can program in there where it will actually use some the resistance, or it will have resistance in the VFD that will slow that motor down and stop it faster. Before I just turned this thing off, the inertia in that big wheel up there, it's basically a big flywheel, it might take 30, 45 seconds for the thing to wind down, up to a minute. So there's a lot of inertia. Like I said, it's like that big wheel is like a big flywheel. The problem I had was there was so much inertia in it that it was overpowering the resistance that was built into the VFD. And we were actually getting an error code on here for overvoltage. So basically what's happening when we turn the motor off, but it's still spinning, this motor becomes a generator, and it's generating voltage, and that voltage is going back into the VFD. Now, with the braking mechanism, you have resistance in there, and it's just like a brake on an electric car. You know, instead of hitting friction, putting on the disc brake or whatever, like in a normal car, in an electric car, you create resistance, and that charges the battery. It's creating voltage that goes back into the battery, and that's what it uses to slow down the car. In this case, we're using a resistor to actually create that resistance, electronic resistor, and that uses that energy that's being generated here, and it slows the motor down faster. So the solution to the problem was I needed a bigger resistor, and these things are designed exactly for that. There's actually circuitry in there. You put a resistor in. So I went ahead and purchased, I don't know if you can see it or not, but there's this little block right here on the side that we mounted, and that's a giant resistor. And now whenever we hit the brake, you can actually see this thing slow down and stop. But we're having to use this larger resistor than what is built into the VFD itself because of the amount of inertia that's in the wheel. So enough talking. I'm going to fire it up, let you guys see this thing run. I'm going to show you kind of from this view first. We're going to take a couple different views around. You can kind of see what's going on. So we'll start her up. So I got you where you can kind of see the motor and the pulleys and all that. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to start it up. And when I do, it does have, but again, that soft start. It takes about 10 seconds to get up to speed. We can program that in the VFD, how long we want that to take. And we may play around with some of those, but that's where we're at right now. 10 seconds to start up, working good. And now I'm going to hit the stop button, and it's going to actually have that resistance in there to slow that wheel down. And again, right now I have it programmed for a 10 second deacceleration. We could probably go a little bit more than that. I think we got enough resistance in that resistor that we got to slow it down even faster, but I don't want it to come to a screeching stop, but I don't want this thing to take a minute to spin down. So anyway, you can kind of see that. Let's pull around here to the end where you can kind of see this belt and what it's doing and how this belt guard works. So I'm gonna hit the start button, and you can see that belt kind of run over there to the side, but then it real quickly jumps back over. It's going to speed on up, and now I'm going to go ahead and stop it. And stopping it, it doesn't seem like it's moving around on the pulley at all. But that little belt guard, again, we'll make sure that that belt doesn't jump off the pulley like we were having some issues with at the beginning of this whole exercise. Over on the front of the machine, kind of right up underneath the table here, I have the control station. that will control the VFD. And we got four different things in here. And one of them is a little bit redundant, but I'll go over it here in a second. So we have the green button, we'll start. The red button will stop. The second red button, this is an e-stop, emergency stop. And it does the same function as pushing this button, but on this one here, you got this mushroom in there. If you're sitting here using your hands or whatever, you can actually lean into that and bump it, and it closes that, and that's gonna stop it. Now, if you close it, you have to manually pull that back out in order to be able to restart the machine. So you got two ways to stop it. And then the fourth one over here is a potentiometer. It's just a dial. This is a speed control. You turn this knob, and that's what's going to speed things up and slow it down. And we'll show you how that works. So here we go again. Start it up. Wheel starts turning. We'll let it get up to speed. And again, using the potentiometer, I got speed control here. I can slow that wheel way down, or I can speed it up with just the dial there. And we have the regular stop button that stops it there. Again, the dynamic braking in there with the resistor will slow it down a little bit faster. Maybe speed that up a little bit and try it out before we get done. We're gonna start it back up. And if I wanna use the e-stop, again, push it in, and it shuts down. When the e-stop is pushed in, it won't restart until I pull that back out, and now it'll restart. There we go. Well, guys, I'm pretty happy with how things have turned out using the variable frequency drive on the bandsaw. That was not my intentional plan, so I'm just gonna put a motor starter on this, but kind of in retrospect, now that we've done it, I really think it was the right thing to do. I really like having the motor control functions that we are using with that variable frequency drive. Again, the soft start, so that we're not just slipping and trying to start this big, huge wheel with all the inertia in it. We're not starting it up real fast from beginning. We kind of ease into it, and we also have that brake in it for deacceleration, so it's not taking a really long time to spin down. Which I think will be a nice safety feature on this saw, because when you hit that stop button, you don't want the blade turning for another 30, 45 seconds or a minute. It was, like I said, it was taking a while for this thing to actually spin down. So with the deacceleration in there, like right now it's on 10 seconds, I'm gonna try to bump it down and see what we can get away with and maybe slow it down a little bit faster. But we've got complete control over that. So a lot of controls in a variable frequency drive, which is what a VFD or variable frequency drive is designed for, is motor control. Next step here is I need to get the guides put on this. We're gonna get a bandsaw blade put on it. I need to crown the wheels on this thing. And I'm sitting here thinking, there's gotta be, there's something else that's gotta be done, and I can't think of what it is right now, but we're getting really close to having this thing wrapped up, I do believe, which I'm happy that we're gonna be wrapping this thing up soon. This machine has been here a long time, been working on it kind of as I have time, and it needs to leave the shop so that we can start on some new projects in here. So guys, with that is going to be a wrap. As always, thanks so much for watching. Please do subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. Those thumbs up and comments are always greatly appreciated. They really help out with the algorithms over on YouTube so that my site can be found by other folks. And as always, too, a big, huge thank you to the guys who do take the time to subscribe, as well as those who are able to contribute a little bit financially through Patreon and PayPal, etc., because it really makes a difference and really enables me to be able to justify spending the time, the extra time it takes to make these videos for you guys. And I really do appreciate you guys that do that as well. With that, we're gonna sign off. We'll catch you on the next video. Thanks for watching.